We learn to live and live to learn in what has turned out to be an unprecedented situation, an unprecedented pandemic. With history being written across the geography of Mother Earth, and a minor virus has created a major catastrophe, making us rethink, reboot, reset, reformat before we rebuild a new future, a new normal. The only thing constant, they say, is change. In a pandemic, the only thing certain is uncertainty. Progress necessitates change, but the fact is that all progress does not come from change, and all change does not lead to progress. So which are the changes which are important, which will be the solutions to the new challenges thrown in this very, very new normal? That becomes a subject of debate, discussion, opinion sharing, as well as evolution. And for that, at edumate.tv, we believe in building the ecosphere with teachers, parents, students, and luminaries in the world of education to try and understand what will be the critical aspects to anticipate, analyze, and evolve in the new normal. Today, we have a very special guest list with us to discuss that. And as always, it's edumate.tv which produces the show, but it's a very special organization from the north of India, IMS, which powers the show for today. Because IMS, like Edumate, believes that every challenge throws open a new opportunity. Every crisis throws open some new doors. And that becomes the new normal for our young students and for all of us as we evolve into a better future for the world of education. So I welcome each and every one of you luminaries. There are lovely names of them, diverse sectors, most of them from the field of education. Let's take a look at who they are. Well, first up, let's get our very special guest, Professor Alok Gupta. Thank you for joining us, sir. Alok Pandeyji, Director and CEO of IMS Ghaziabad. You've been an exemplary speaker and a luminary in terms of thinking. I've had the pleasure of interacting with you on so many occasions and learned so much from you. Now, that having been said, we're learning by the day, because every day is almost a work in progress for the new normal. What have been your signature learnings over these last couple of months?
A lot of people tell that these 2 months are black swan events. It's a black swan event. Never before we've seen this amount of, this amount of uncertainty about future has never been felt before. We never felt, as a matter of fact, that this would happen. But the fact is, human beings have a very short memory, and probably this will pass and the next event would come and we again would say that, whoa, what has happened? So one of the biggest learnings of these last 3 months has been that human beings have started realizing that what is it that they can and can't do without. One of the things everyone has learned that we can live with very little. You know, Mahatma Gandhi said the world has enough for every man's need, but not enough for one man's greed. People are now looking at WTO once again, whether what we created as World Trade Organization is going to serve the purpose anymore, if every nation is going to become Atmanirbhar and every nation is going to create, chart a path of its own through its own people, through its own resources. So these, some of the biggest things of last 2-3 months have been, number one, that we can live with very little. Number two, it has falsified almost every theory in economics in last 50 to 60 years. And it has the capacity to falsify even more if we do not come forward and start saying, no, not everything is wrong. One of the biggest things I have realized that almost every research which was done about COVID in last 3 months turned out to be wrong. Is your initial idea of organizing webinars is now becoming a movement. it took me around a month or two to, you know, speak to my colleagues and get with them and identify that, yes, this works. And what is happening today that we can conducted during COVID-36 webinars, five paid FDPs. Today also, 2 o'clock onwards on research, we are doing a webinar along with speakers from all across the country. COVID has given us another boundary. We are testing our own boundaries for ethics. We are testing our own boundaries for hard work. And of course, as time passes by, these young people probably will turn out to be more ethical people because they are the only ones looking at themselves.
Right. Sir.
So as you know, these are major 3-4 ideas out of it. Apart from that, of course, there's a lot on economic management. You'll hear from other colleagues who are present here. There's a lot on education management. Like, for example, the biggest problem is now, what, as I said in the last webinar, if you believe, exams or no exams, will it change the quality? And just see what has happened with the CBSE Class 12 results.
Sure.
Today's newspaper says that the number of people holding 90% and above marks has risen 119%. What does that mean? What has CBSE done? What they have done, they can never be forgiven by teachers for several years to come. What they have done, if suppose a student could not give two papers, they'll average out other three papers and give him the marks in those papers. So I, for example, I appeared in physics, chemistry and mathematics, but I could not give Hindi. So I got 100 marks in physics, chemistry and mathematics. You will grant 100 to me in Hindi as well? Do they not know that if, for example, the degrees of these hundreds and thousands of students rejected by the University Grants Commission, what would happen? So there's a fight between two governments probably. There are two political dispensations, different political dispensations at two different center and state level.
Yes, sir.
And you take a decision suddenly. So somewhere I think I have very grave, I see a very grave future when educational institutions are taken so lightly and educational systems are taken so lightly by the administrators and policymakers.
Sure.
So let the teachers also come in. Let the teachers also think. So I think post COVID, 6 months later, everybody would say, let's discuss first with teachers before we take a decision on academic calendars and examinations.
I think it is very aptly mentioned that the concept of new normal, and we should learn to live with the concept of new normal. And we should also design our thinking process to cope up with this type of unprecedented pandemic. I also wholeheartedly second what Professor Pandey has highlighted in the beginning, that we should learn to live with little. And I'm sure anything can be fulfilled with our will and efforts. And let me tell you, like the way you said, that there are some people should work dedicatedly, committedly to fight with this thing. And let me tell you, we are the one, those who are fighting with this type of situations. Education in general and management education in particular has an indispensable role to play in economic growth, that we all know it, right? But COVID-19 confronts the education system with new and massive crisis. If you allow me, I have few points to tell you. The first point is the new normal look like the future generations. How can the educational institutions use the innovativeness of recovery period to build back the better? How we build back it? How we fight it with it? Second, the learning crisis due to closure of educational institutions. Let me give you data. According to UNESCO, more than 87% of the world's student population, that is over 1.5 billion learners in 165 countries, have been affected by temporary closure of educational institutions due to this COVID-19 pandemic. Now, what should we do for this? The first point, that we need to have a stronger domestic and an international collaboration involving the government at different levels, corporations, international public-private partnership. That might help to provide a better focus, deliver solutions, and generate common digital goods. Second, that educational institutions like us need to practice the resilience and adaptability.
If we had not closed the institutions, the buildings, mind you, the buildings are closed, teaching learning has not stopped. Pandeji has given enough witness to say that the teachers kept teaching learning process alive and continued. Only the building has closed, Pandeji, and thanks, salute the teachers. But had the government not closed the buildings and our children would have fallen sick, we would not have spared the government. It was essential to close buildings to keep children at home so that they don't suffer. I'm not very much in favor of the averaging of results. I have said on other platforms, we have a system of on-demand exam in the country. We have been holding the board exam, 12th board, 10th board, every day of the year through the National Institute of Open Schooling. We should have done that. 2021, you will have 40 crore children suffering from education, loss of education. 40 crore children would be ill because they have not been taught. And that these 2 years will make them suffer lifelong. We have been saying, if you want to help a person for a day, give him a meal. If you want to serve a person for a lifetime, give him the skill, the technique. I think this is the time. Develop the skill in the teachers to teach online, what we have been saying as blended learning, and learners to learn online. It's not auto shift. Teaching online is not automatic. We need to immediately train our teachers to teach online. The damage that is being done in teaching online will make children suffer for a very long time, maybe lifetime. But the good thing is they are shifting platform. This is what we have to learn, learning to learn. So they are shifting platform, they are learning to shift from platform, and that should become the new normal. I believe we have quite a lot of silver lining, but we have so much to learn and act for the future. Otherwise, our children would suffer for the lifetime. This is the time to change gear and start a new beginning.
What we're talking about is designing of this new normal about, in the education sphere. And this designing of new normal, according to me, has to be done at various levels. Of course, there are various changes which have taken place. A very good thing is that people have started experimenting with the online learning mode, which is a very good thing. So as teachers, now, one thing which is of concern to me is that, as a teacher, as an educationist, I've been using the digital platforms earlier as well, like the Google Classroom and the others. But we've started experimenting with more platforms like Zoom and others. So that is a good part of it. But, when we're talking about designing of the new normal, we need to take care of certain things. Of course, we do understand that after this pandemic situation, there is going to be a blended learning. Now, this physical as well as online mode, is going to blend. And therefore, the teaching is going to be very different. Now, the question that arises is, are we actually prepared for it in terms of, the digital divide which exists, first thing? Whether we like it or not, we have to talk about the digital divide. So we need to work around, getting the infrastructure available in terms of accessibility, in terms of reaching out to those who do not have, the access. A lot of parents want their students, their kids to be competitive in today's world. Mm-hmm. Have we changed that definition of being competitive? Is getting a 90 on a 95%+ marks, is that good enough for preparing a kid to face the world or to go out and start working? So that definition of being competitive needs to change. And for that, we need to bring about a change in the mindset of the parents, of the students, of the teachers. So just that emphasis on marks, of course it is important, yes. But that doesn't mean that we can ignore the other skills not work on the other things. In fact, a lot of opportunities do exist in terms of, a lot of students who are skilled. During this pandemic time, the government has also introduced a lot of initiatives. For example, the MSME sector is now open to all those people who have the required skills. we also need to design the new normal in terms of, you know, changing those traditional definitions of the kids being competitive. It doesn't depend on the marks only. Mm-hmm. And then a very important thing which the pandemic has taught us, you know, because a lot of people are talking about the stress situation and how to handle that stress.
Right.
Why can't we have, you know, that thing inculcated, you know, somewhere in the students right from the school, you know, where they are taught how to deal with stress, rather than, you know, putting them in that box of, you know, being competitive, you know, by, you know, you need to score more marks and, you know, building a pressure on them throughout the school, throughout the college, and then teaching them after college how to deal with that stress.
Right.
So I think all that also needs to change.
So my point here is that a lot of discussions and debates are going on, education policy, parents, students. Perhaps I see it that we should try our best to retrospectively tell students and parents that what world has gone through and how world evolved and how education systems evolved and where we are right now. So there was an era, there was an agriculture era, there was a mechanical era, there was an electronic era, and we are in the IT era. So most of the devices which we are using these days are basically used, or even last 10-15 years, for students, for parents, for everyone, used like as if it's a communication device. My mobile phone, my laptops, all are used as a communication device. Then it was involved, inculcated into the education systems, and people started using laptops and other devices to study. But the problem is, and the best and the worst part is, the best part I would say is that, for instance, if a third grade student, fifth grade student, seventh grade student, these days they are attending all these their sessions online. So they are becoming used to, so they are becoming habitual that this is the new normal. That, for instance, if we do not go to college, we do not go to school, that doesn't mean we will not learn or our education is over. No. If we do not have access to books, we have Google and other platforms to access all the data. So right now, I believe that we are taking the benefit of technology, actual benefit of technology, using a so-called in our education system. That with limited resources, we can do a lot of things. But most unfortunately, we were so habitual of exploiting these resources that we started using this only for the benefit ourselves, for ourselves, not for the benefits of others. So my life's motto, I'm connecting it here, serve others, is that if I develop something, if I design something, if I can come back with some new innovative ideas to change the education system, I can contribute. And that is the best thing for an individual, that if he can use his subconscious mind and intellect to bring in the change in the society, anything and everything is possible.
Corona or no corona, we have been suffering a lot on the educational front. Relatively, whatever earlier speakers, Dr. Pandey, Dr. Tapas, Dr. Sharma, and Ruchi also, all they have emphasized that we have to improve the quality of education. Right? We have limited resources, no doubt. But those limited resources are to be utilized in an efficient and fully manner. The resources must not be used in an inefficient manner. Right, what we have been doing till now, we have been producing graduates, management graduates, MBAs and all that. But whether they are employed in industries, whether we have trained them in our institution to the extent that the soft skill have been developed in them, and so that the industry is ready to take as they have been trained in that? No, we have not given them sufficient training to the extent, to the requirement of the industry. So what they do, industry employ them and then again send them for a training, 6 months to 3 months training. So we have to educate them in a manner that they are ready to be adopted by the industry, number one. Number two, second thing you talked about, we have limited resources and employability there is a problem, or entrepreneurship is also not being thoroughly, you know, developed in each and every student. Whether we want to develop them in a confident and industry ready person, we have to train them. Not only we have to educate them in our syllabus. So this is the requirement. Whether the institutions like IMS, is a partner to this webinar. So they should think in a different line as such, whether they can develop some productive unit among themselves.
But when you talk about employability, this new normal has given us enough evidence that when you keep the onus on the students, you know, they have to perform for themselves, the accountability lies with the students, they have left no stones unturned and they have shown themselves that they are capable. For example, you know, there was a news which was flashed by you at the beginning of this webinar where some of the IIT students have created an app for these Shramik laborers. And a lot of them are in the orphanage, so you get to hear about them on radio, television, etc. So, you know, when I talk about employability, of course, that has been a factor because, again, there was a news, a piece of news item which talked about that we produce engineers as many as the population of Australia, but their employability is a big question. When you talk about employability, you know, one very important factor which is surrounding the student community is that their social, emotional well-being has to be taken care of. You know, now is the time when counselors, psychologists are needed the most. So I think the teachers also need to be trained, not just to impart the skills which help them fetch an employment, but also to mentor them, to counsel them, to you know, to counter the stress of any situation and you know, to bring out utmost productivity amongst the students. So I think that should be the part of the new model.
Talking about opportunities, I would like to give you a reflection of the opportunity that has transformed, the transformation of opportunity that I have had. Apart from teaching at Delhi University in Gargi College, I also train students for UPSC. So I have a free module for IES training. Now, last year, through the brick and mortar model and through personal guidance, I had 3 students. And out of them, 2 of them got selected in Indian Economic Service, rank 4 and rank 30. Now, this is a completely free platform that I have. Now, what this entire opportunity of due to the veil of creative destruction, which Schumacher highlights, is that this has given an immense opportunity to edtech, to digitalization of education. And it is during this time that I personally started a YouTube channel, which is called as The Pink Professor. Now, the opportunity that it created was that now this now with approximately 30 videos that I have more than 530 subscribers. There are 21 colleges students from 21 colleges of Delhi University which are on that platform. And for example, yesterday I got a call from Serbia, a student from Serbia who wanted certain lessons on Stata. At this particular point of time is that there should be a stakeholders approach, and with the stakeholders approach, the union government should pass an ordinance with respect to how to conduct the examination. Right. And lastly, my point is regarding taking forward Dr. Gupta's point that we need a learning outcome-based system. Now, time and again, our focus has been on only on testing, on only on evaluation, and not on assessment. We need to see the learning outcome that is happening after the education is over. Where is the exit test? Where is the employability? And that is where there is a lot of scope of AI, induction of AI. Unfortunately, because of the pandemic, the induction of AI into education is going to fasten up.
But before changing the mindset, I think in this new normal, we are facing a lot of problems. Problem in the sense that we have noticed high obsession for online education by UGC and other educational institutions. It would be worth mentioning the statement of Professor Puhad, who was the head of a panel on academic calendar and examination formed by UGC. In his interview published in the Outlook, he said, "We have recommended that from the next session, at least 25% component of syllabus should be taken up through online system." It is clear from his statement that online education is not going to be a temporary arrangement only for this upcoming session, but going to become a permanent phenomenon due to colonial mindset of Indian people. This will result in homogenization of education. Students will learn everything in American or European context. In fact, I'm afraid if some good Indian teachers are going to teach Indian students living in the remote areas, that is also going to have similar impact. We are still facing this problem when most textbooks taught in top Indian universities are of foreign authors with examples mostly centric to America or Europe. However, Indian teachers try to provide Indian context while teaching in the classroom. But if same content is being taught by these foreign teachers, they will not be able to give Indian context to our students.
But I want to say that we should prepare in a pandemic condition for new innovation like digital learning and online education, and how to prepare students for digital learning for his future. We are facing some problem for digital learning, but I hope let us solve this problem like network issue in rural areas.
We have to go back to the basics, because the entire structure that we have in our country, and due to the pandemic, our cracks are showing. Wherever we moved on, leaving some people behind, those are showing now. Specifically on the female education front, we see that on the primary and the secondary front, whatever gains that we saw in the couple of last 10 years after the RTE was declared in 2009, all of the gains that we see might just be pulled away because of COVID-19, because we are moving on to the online classroom system. You know, we see that women in the Ebola pandemic as well, we saw that 5 to 10% of African girls who were going to school just pulled away from the secondary education sector because, you know, their parents probably did not allow, and there was domestic work that was very heavy on them, and they just pulled back and never completed their education, and probably these girls are not employed anymore, are not independent anymore because of the pandemic that came in. So we need to recognize the long-term, salient, palpable barriers that exist, not just on terms of digital divide, but on the social and cultural norms. Right now, specifically when we're looking at COVID-19, we should also focus on the number of girls who will be educated, because there is a risk on these girls being vulnerable and pulling away from the education system, despite how much your education system and institutions will be strong and they're providing your online education. But we need to focus on how many girls are actually coming to get access to this online education, because of course, as we see, the world is available to everyone, but we need to focus on the barriers that exist, very salient and palpable barriers that exist to these girls in the rural areas, specifically in India, that they will not come online to study.
You know, we cannot let all the progress that we've made with female education, female employability just go away because of the pandemic. But we also need to see, as Manvika pointed out, that people are made aware of the employability. So as per, you know, the latest CMI data, the unemployment rates have fallen down drastically, have risen up drastically because of the lockdown being imposed. And also, if you see, you know, with the increase of burden of care work on women especially, the productive, maybe, you know, women will get more opportunities to work because now all the work is being done from home. But we also, we should also point out that the productivity of these women might go down because all the burden of care work will be on them. They will have extra childcare responsibilities.
Whenever you are at the cusp of a new normal, you're bound to have new challenges, new solutions. You're bound to have new opportunities. You're bound to have new people who despair. And you're bound to have a new system of thinking, a shift in mindset. Now, what is going to be that new system? We're going to have closing comments in just a moment, Sleema. Well, we've got about 20 minutes to go in the show. I'm going to first take closing comments from Professor Pandey. First addressing a lot of points that were made in terms of relevance of education, employability, in terms of open book examination, in terms of a change in the mindset, in terms of digital divide. You heard a lot of statements. Then I'm going to take a 1 minute reaction time from each of our panelists to understand three critical opportunities for our students, three critical opportunities in the new normal.
Singapore and Germany and some other countries, they, you know, segregate students at their scholastic abilities, using their scholastic abilities at the school level, and they don't allow everyone to go to higher education. This is contrary to what we follow in India, where everybody is going and doing a graduation in some or the other subject. So what the result is that you have a large number of people who have a degree, but it is just a paper degree. I always compare this kind of degree distribution as equivalent to printing notes. You know, when you print notes, you have inflation and the value of currency goes down. Similarly, when you print degrees in large numbers, the value of degree goes down because they are of no use. So CII, FICCI, ASSOCHAM, Government of India, everybody has come forward and they have said that no, our graduates are unemployable. So why do you have so many people for graduation? This is a point. So let me tell you, entrepreneurship education and life skills, you've got to begin them, initiate them at the point of the schools. So once at the school level, our students start learning about stress. Now, in a country where still parents are telling their children that, you know, if a child asks a question to their parents, mommy, how was I born? So father comes in between and say, beta, I brought you from the hospital. So we are not very clear as to how do we teach our children about basic life skills. We still are very, very, we do not allow our students, our children at home and students in school to be inquisitive.
Right.
Tell them that you are a result of sex. What is wrong about it? So we say Vasudhaiv Kutumbakam, we must understand the global models. We must adapt some of them in local setting. And we start looking at the entire issue in a holistic model as to what education should do. Education is not only employability. Education is about critical thinking. Education is about identifying what is right and wrong. And education is about creating leaders for tomorrow. And that is what I, as a director of the Institute of Management Studies, have been trying to do. And I hope that all my colleagues in education will also try to do. Rather than imposing ideas on the students, let them be inquisitive. And let us start saying, you should be the leader of tomorrow.
There are a few points, let me tell you, how IMS Ghaziabad has taken this change positively. One, let me tell you, since March 22nd, March 24th, 2020, we have completed all our classes, remaining classes online. We have completed all the examinations by using our own ERP systems. We have conducted all the presentations online. And let me tell you very proudly, Chetan, that we have conducted almost over 40 webinars for our students and faculty members. We have conducted 6 to 7 FDPs, where Professor Pandey has already highlighted that all the FDPs has gone full of the participants. And second, that I have already highlighted that due to these poor market conditions, because of the job conditions, but let me tell you one thing, with the help of our very efficient, highly effective corporate resource center, leading by Ms. Charu Sharma, we have been able to place all our students so far as their summer internship is concerned.
Do not equate education to employability. We create human beings, we don't create employees, we don't create servants. Our motto is, our objective is to create good human beings. How is it? All IIT graduates are employable, all others are not. So don't tell me that academia is not preparing people for jobs. It's your job to do that. We are creating, our job is to create best human beings, and that's what we do. Second, everybody knows what is education. Why are you now crying horse about decisions in education? You have put education decisions in the hands of those who have never been in education. educational decisions must be taken by those who have been in it, who have been to classroom, who know education. You bring management trainees to take decisions. You bring politicians to decide about certification and examination. They will care more about votes than about certificates. Why are you crying now?
Outside India, for instance, if somebody is a dropout from college and he does something, so he's promoted that he's a dropout, and see, he's doing wonders. He has contributed a lot in the society. Unfortunately, I would say most unfortunately, if something happens in India, the person is targeted that he has not been able to finish his education. Why? That's very simple answer, that our strength is something else. We are the traders community. We have been doing this for thousands of years. Are they going to teach us what trading is, what entrepreneurship is, what business is? No, it is our fault. Perhaps we have accepted, like Professor Sharma said, we have accepted the so-called British Raj or whatever system. We have to take it as in stand and say, no, I'm a 10th graduate, I'm a 5th graduate, I have a PhD or whatever. If I can do something, I can. And I'll proudly. So we have to learn this. Now, every time we talk about startups, entrepreneurship, 2007, when words started so-called sinking, in 2008, this financial turmoil, I request all the students to go back and study how many companies were started from 2007 to 2010. All the big chaps you see right now, Uber, Ola, Swiggy, Zomato, Flipkart, all these companies were started when the world is suffering. There was no finance, no money. And we are referring to just because of 3 months we are sitting at home or 6 months we are sitting at home, we are so worried our future is what we are going to do, what happened to a job and X, Y, Z. Why did you go and read the history? Last 10 years, I'm saying.
I believe that a lot of students have time now at their disposal to pursue some online courses, and that too from the best of universities. And most of them would also come at almost no cost, unless and until you are wanting to earn a certificate. That is one thing. Another thing is that due to COVID situation, the government has announced a lot of measures for the MSME sector. So the students should not just worry about that they're not getting internships or placements. Why don't they look this as an opportunity to become job creators rather than job seekers?
So one opportunity which this COVID has come up with is rural transformation. Students who are sitting in by far villages who were not able to pursue the kind of courses which they would wanted to, now they can do that thanks to technology. If we can take care of this digital divide, I think it can. This COVID can provide a great opportunity for rural transformation. And the second is the agility. Okay, the students will be able. They're learning to be more agile.
Opportunities from my point of view is that I'm talking about those students who are serious about their education and career. These COVID-19 have given them an opportunity that they have sufficient time. They have saved their time in commuting, going to the colleges and sitting there. Sometimes classes are held, sometimes not held. They have sufficient time to be creative, to be innovative.
I just want to provide a historical analysis to this. In 1870, Japan was the last entrant to the race of industrial revolution. And in 30 years, just by spending huge amounts of money on its education, it was able to transform itself. And by 1905, a country of the size of Japan was able to challenge Russia and defeat it. We today are at the cusp of another industrial revolution, the fourth industrial revolution. And everything from 10 years from now, 20, 15 years from now, will be running on artificial intelligence. This is the time where students need to imbibe and need to learn the skill sets of this, which will be required in the next 40-50 odd years.
I think I would point out in terms of the economic purview on the types of funding that we are receiving from big companies. Like, yes, I think just a few days ago it was announced that Google is investing $100 billion in the Indian market on the digital infrastructure. So, when a certain sector comes up, you don't just require people who are specialists in, let's say, if the healthcare is coming up, we just don't require doctors. We want a whole army of people who are business graduates, who are web developers, who are education specialists in all these fields. So there's a certain sunrise sectors coming up in the economy, which are, let's say, the digital infrastructure, healthcare, pharmaceutical companies, and you have solar energy being focused on now because we need renewable energy, and we should focus on these when students are looking for opportunities.
We've come to a close of this session. We'll see you another time in another session. But for now, I often say that the only way to fight the big C called COVID is by three C's. The three C's of being collective, corrective, and creative. And of course, don't forget, to educate better, you better educate.